Story 193 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. The Drummer. A young drummer went out quite alone one evening into the country and came to a lake on the shore of which he perceived three pieces of white linen lying. "What fine linen," said he, and put one piece in his pocket. He returned home, thought no more of what he had found, and went to bed. Just as he was going to sleep, it seemed to him as if someone was saying his name. He listened and was aware of a soft voice which cried to him, "Drummer! Drummer, wake up!" As it was a dark night, he could see no one, but it appeared to him that a figure was hovering about his bed. "What do you want?" he asked. "Give me back my dress," answered the voice, "what you took away from me last evening by the lake." "You shall have it back again," said the drummer, "if you will tell me who you are." "Ah," replied the voice, "I am the daughter of a mighty king, but I have fallen into the power of a witch and am shut up on the glass mountain. I have to bathe in the lake every day with my two sisters, but I cannot fly back again without my dress. My sisters have gone away, but I have been forced to stay behind. I entreat you to give me my dress back."
"Be easy, poor child," said the drummer. "I will willingly give it back to you."
He took it out of his pocket and reached it to her in the dark. She snatched it in haste and wanted to go away with it. "Stop a moment. Perhaps I can help you." "You can only help me by ascending the glass mountain and freeing me from the power of the witch. But you cannot come to the glass mountain, and indeed, if you were quite close to it, you could not ascend it."
"When I want to do a thing, I always can do it," said the drummer. "I am sorry for you, and I have no fear of anything, but I do not know the way which leads to the glass mountain."
"The road goes through the great forest in which the man-eaters live," she answered, "and more than that, I dare not tell you." And then he heard her wings quiver as she flew away. By daybreak, the drummer arose, buckled in his drum, and went without fear straight into the forest. After he had walked for a while without seeing any giants, he thought to himself, "I must waken up the sluggards," and he hung his drum before him and beat such a reveille that the birds flew out of the trees with loud cries. It was not long before a giant who had been lying sleeping among the grass rose up and was as tall as a fir tree.
"Wretch," cried he, "what art thou drumming here for and wakening me out of my best sleep?"
"I am drumming," he replied, "because I want to show the way to many thousands who are following me."
"What do you want in my forest?" demanded the giant.
"They want to put an end to thee and cleanse the forest of such a monster as thou art."
"Oho!" said the giant. "I will trample you all to death like so many ants."
"Dost thou think thou canst do anything against us?" said the drummer. "If thou stoopest to take hold of one, he will jump away and hide himself. But when thou art lying down and sleeping, they will come forth from every thicket and creep up to thee. Every one of them has a hammer of steel in his belt, and with that they will beat in thy skull." The giant grew angry and thought, "If I meddle with the crafty folk, it might turn out badly for me. I can strangle wolves and bears, but I cannot protect myself from these earthworms."
"Listen, little fellow," said he, "go back again, and I will promise you that for the future I will leave you and your comrades in peace. And if there is anything else you wish for, tell me, for I am quite willing to do something to please you."
"Thou hast long legs," said the drummer, "and canst run quicker than I. Carry me to the glass mountain, and I will give my followers a signal to go back, and they shall leave thee in peace this time."
"Come here, worm," said the giant. "Seat thyself on my shoulder. I will carry thee where thou wishest to be."
The giant lifted him up, and the drummer began to beat his drum aloft to his heart's delight.
The giant thought, "That is the signal for the other people to turn back."
After a while, a second giant was standing in the road, who took the drummer from the first and stuck him in his buttonhole. The drummer laid hold of the button, which was as large as a dish, held on by it, and looked merrily around. Then they came to a third giant, who took him out of the buttonhole and set him on the rim of his hat. Then the drummer walked backwards and forwards up above and looked over the trees, and when he perceived a mountain in the blue distance, he thought,
That must be the glass mountain, and so it was. The giant only made 2 steps more, and they reached the foot of the mountain, where the giant put him down. The drummer demanded to be put on the summit of the glass mountain, but the giant shook his head, growled something in his beard, and went back into the forest. And now the poor drummer was standing before the mountain, which was as high as if 3 mountains were piled on each other, and at the same time as smooth as a looking-glass, and did not know how to get up it. He began to climb, but that was useless, for he always slipped back again. If one was a bird now, thought he, but what was the good of wishing? No wings grew for him. Whilst he was standing thus, not knowing what to do, he saw, not far from him, 2 men who were struggling fiercely together. He went up to them and saw that they were disputing about a saddle which was lying on the ground before them, and which both of them wanted to have. "What fools you are," said he, "to quarrel about a saddle when you have not a horse for it?" "The saddle is worth fighting about," answered one of the men. "Whosoever sits on it and wishes himself in any place, even if it should be the very end of the earth, gets there the instant he has uttered the wish. The saddle belongs to us in common. It is my turn to ride on it, but the other man will not let me do it." "I will soon decide the quarrel," said the drummer, and he went to a short distance and stuck a white rod in the ground. Then he came back and said, "Now run to the goal, and whoever gets there first shall ride first." Both put themselves into a trot, but hardly had they gone a couple of steps before the drummer swung himself on the saddle, wished himself on the glass mountain, and before anyone could turn round, he was there. On the top of the mountain was a plain. There stood an old stone house, and in front of the house lay a great fish pond, but behind it was a dark forest. He saw neither men nor animals. Everything was quiet. Only the wind rustled amongst the trees, and the clouds moved by quite close above his head. He went to the door and knocked. When he had knocked for the 3rd time, an old woman with a brown face and red eyes opened the door. She had spectacles on her long nose and looked sharply at him. Then she asked what he wanted. "Entrance, food, and a bed for the night," replied the drummer. "That thou shalt have," said the old woman, "if thou wilt perform 3 services in return." "Why not?" he answered. "I am not afraid of any kind of work, however hard it may be." The old woman let him go in, and gave him some food and a good bed at night. The next morning, when he had had his sleep out, he took a thimble from her wrinkled finger, reached it to the drummer, and said, "Go to work now, and empty out the pond with this thimble. But thou must have it done before night, and must have sought out all the fishes which are in the water, and laid them side by side, according to their kind and size." "That is strange work," said the drummer, but he went to the pond and began to empty it. He bailed the whole morning, but what can anyone do to a great lake with a thimble, even if he were to bail for 1,000 years? When it was noon, he thought, "It is all useless, and whether I work or not, it will come to the same thing." So he gave it up and sat down. Then came a maiden out of the house, who set a little basket with food before him, and said, "What ails thee, that thou sittest so sadly here?" He looked at her and saw that she was wondrously beautiful. "Ah," he said, "I cannot finish the 1st piece of work. How will it be with the others? I came forth to seek a king's daughter who is said to dwell here, but I have not found her, and I will go farther." "Stay here," said the maiden. "I will help thee out of thy difficulty. Thou art tired. Lay thy head in my lap and sleep. When thou awakest again, thy work will be done." The drummer did not need to be told that twice. As soon as his eyes were shut, she turned a wishing ring and said, "Rise, water, fishes, come out." Instantly, the water rose on high like a white mist and moved away with the other clouds. And the fishes sprang on the shore and laid themselves side by side, each according to his size and kind. When the drummer awoke, he saw with amazement that all was done. But the maiden said, "One of the fish is not lying with those of its own kind, but quite alone. When the old woman comes tonight and sees that all she demanded has been done, she will ask thee, 'Why is this fish lying alone for?' Then throw the fish in her face and say, 'This one shall be for thee, old witch.'" In the evening the witch came, and when she had put this question, he threw the fish in her face. She behaved as if she did not remark it and said nothing, but looked at him with a malicious eye. Next morning she said, "Yesterday was too easy for thee. I must give thee harder work. Today thou must hew down the whole of the forest, split the wood into logs, and pile them up, and everything must be finished by evening." She gave him an axe, a mallet, and two wedges. But the axe was made of lead, and the mallet and wedges were of tin. When he began to cut, the edge of the axe turned back, and the mallet and wedges were beaten out of shape. He did not know how to manage, but at midday the maiden came once more with his dinner and comforted him. "Lay thy head on my lap," said she, "and sleep. When thou awakest, thy work will be done." She turned her wishing ring, and in an instant the whole forest fell down with a crash. The wood split and arranged itself in heaps, and it seemed just as if unseen giants were finishing the work. When he awoke, the maiden said, "Dost thou see that the wood is piled up and arranged? One bough alone remains, and when the old woman comes this evening and asks thee about that bough, give her a blow with it, and say, 'That is for thee, thou witch.'" The old woman came. "There, thou seest how easy the work was," said she. "But for whom hast thou left that bough which is lying there still?" "For thee, thou witch," he replied, and gave her a blow with it. But she pretended not to feel it, laughed scornfully, and said, "Early tomorrow morning thou shalt arrange all the wood in one heap. Set fire to it and burn it." He rose at break of day and began to pick up the wood. But how can a single man get a whole forest together? The work made no progress. The maiden, however, did not desert him in his need. She brought him his food at noon, and when he had eaten, he laid his head on her lap and went to sleep. When he awoke, the entire pile of wood was burning in one enormous flame, which stretched its tongues out into the sky. "Listen to me," said the maiden. "When the witch comes, she will give thee all kinds of orders. Do whatever she asks thee, without fear, and then she will not be able to get the better of thee. But if thou art afraid, the fire will lay hold of thee and consume thee. At last, when thou hast done everything, seize her with both thy hands and throw her into the midst of the fire." The maiden departed, and the old woman came sneaking up to him. "Oh, I am cold," said she, "but that is a fire that burns. It warms my old bones for me and does me good. But there is a log lying there which won't burn. Bring it to me. When thou hast done that, thou art free, and mayst go where thou likest. Come, go in with a good will." The drummer did not reflect long. He sprang into the midst of the flames, and they did not hurt him, and could not even singe a hair of his head. He carried the log out and laid it down. Hardly, however, had the wood touched the earth than it was transformed, and the beautiful maiden who had helped him in his need stood before him, and by the silken and shining golden garments which she wore, he knew right well that she was the king's daughter. But the old woman laughed venomously and said, "Thou thinkest thou hast her safe, but thou hast not got her yet." Just as she was about to fall on the maiden and take her away, the youth seized the old woman with both his hands, raised her up on high, and threw her into the jaws of the fire, which closed over her as if it were delighted that an old witch was to be burnt. Then the king's daughter looked at the drummer, and when she saw that he was a handsome youth and remembered how he had risked his life to deliver her, she gave him her hand and said, "Thou hast ventured everything for my sake, but I also will do everything for thine. Promise to be true to me, and thou shalt be my husband. We shall not want for riches. We shall have enough with what the witch has gathered together here." She led him into the house, where there were chests and coffers crammed with old woman's treasures. The maid left the gold and silver where it was, and took only the precious stones. She would not stay any longer on the glass mountain. So the drummer said to her, "Seat thyself by me on my saddle, and then we will fly down like birds." "I do not like the old saddle," said she. "I need only turn my wishing ring, and we shall be at home." "Very well, then," answered the drummer. "Then wish us in front of the town gate." In the twinkling of an eye, they were there. But the drummer said, "I will just go to my parents and tell them the news. Wait for me outside here. I shall soon be back." "Ah," said the king's daughter, "I beg thee to be careful. On thy arrival, do not kiss thy parents on the right cheek, or else thou wilt forget everything, and I shall stay behind here outside, alone and deserted." "How can I forget thee?" said he, and promised her to come back very soon, and gave his hand upon it. When he arrived into his father's house, he had changed so much that no one knew who he was, for the 3 days which he had passed on the glass mountain had been 3 years. Then he made himself known, and his parents fell on his neck with joy, and his heart was so moved that he forgot what the maiden had said and kissed them on both cheeks. But when he had given them the kiss on the right cheek, every thought of the king's daughter vanished from him. He emptied his pockets and laid handfuls of the largest jewels on the table. The parents had not the least idea what to do with the riches. Then the father built a magnificent castle, all surrounded by gardens, woods, and meadows, as if a prince were to live in it. And when it was ready, the mother said, "I have found a maiden for thee, and the wedding shall be in 3 days." The son was content to do as his parents desired. The poor king's daughter had stood for a long time without the town waiting for the return of the young man. When evening came, she said, "He must certainly have kissed his parents on the right cheek, and has forgotten me." Her heart was full of sorrow. She wished herself into a solitary little hut in a forest, and would not return to her father's court. Every evening she went into the town and passed the young man's house. He often saw her, but he no longer knew her. At length she heard the people saying, "The wedding will take place tomorrow." Then she said, "I will try if I can win his heart back." On the first day of the wedding ceremony, she turned her wishing ring and said, "A dress as bright as the sun." Instantly the dress lay before her, and it was as bright as if it had been woven of real sunbeams. When all the guests were assembled, she entered the hall. Everyone was amazed at the beautiful dress, and the bride most of all. And as pretty dresses were the things she had most delight in, she went to the stranger and asked if she would sell it to her. "Not for money," she answered, "but if I may pass the first night outside the door of the room where your betrothed sleeps, I will give it up to you." The bride could not overcome her desire and consented, but she mixed a sleeping draught with the wine her betrothed took at night, which made him fall into a deep sleep. When all had become quiet, the king's daughter crouched down by the door of the bedroom, opened it just a little, and cried, "Drummer, drummer, I pray thee hear, hast thou forgotten thou heldest me dear? That on the glass mountain we sat hour by hour, that I rescued thy life from the witch's power. Didst thou not plight thy troth to me? Drummer, drummer, hearken to me." But it was all in vain. The drummer did not awake, and when the morning dawned, the king's daughter was forced to go back again as she came. On the second evening, she turned her wishing ring and said, "A dress as silvery as the moon." When she appeared at the feast in the dress, which was as soft as moonbeams, it again excited the desire of the bride, and the king's daughter gave it to her for permission to pass the second night also outside the door of the bedroom. Then, in the stillness of the night, she cried, "Drummer, drummer, I pray thee hear, hast thou forgotten thy heldest me dear? That on the glass mountain we sat hour by hour, that I rescued thy life from the witch's power. Didst thou not plight thy troth to me? Drummer, drummer, hearken to me." But the drummer, who was stupefied with the sleeping draught, could not be aroused. Sadly, next morning she went back to her hut in the forest, but the people in the house had heard the lamentation of the stranger maiden and told the bridegroom about it. They told him also that it was impossible that he could hear anything of it, because the maiden he was going to marry had poured a sleeping draught into his wine. On the third evening, the king's daughter turned her wishing ring and said, "A dress glittering like the stars." When she showed herself therein at the feast, the bride was quite beside herself with the splendor of the dress, which far surpassed the others. And she said, "I must and will have it." The maiden gave it, as she had given the others, for permission to spend the night outside the bridegroom's door. The bridegroom, however, did not drink the wine which was handed to him before he went to bed, but poured it behind the bed. And when everything was quiet, he heard a sweet voice which called to him, "Drummer, drummer, I pray thee hear. Hast thou forgotten thou held me dear? That on the glass mountain we sat hour by hour, that I rescued thy life from the witch's power. Didst thou not plight thy troth to me? Drummer, drummer, hearken to me." Suddenly his memory returned to him. "Ah!" cried he, "how can I have acted so unfaithfully? But the kiss which in the joy of my heart I gave my parents on the right cheek, that is to blame for it all. That is what stupefied me." He sprang up, took the king's daughter by the hand, and led her to his parents' bed. "This is my true bride," said he. "If I marry the other, I shall do a great wrong." The parents, when they heard how everything had happened, gave their consent. Then the lights in the hall were lighted again, drums and trumpets were brought, friends and relations were invited to come, and the real wedding was solemnized with great rejoicing. The first bride received the beautiful dresses as compensation and declared herself satisfied. End of story 193, read by Nicole DiDio, Montpelier, Vermont, USA, April 13, 2022.
Story 194 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. The Ear of Corn. In former times, when God himself still walked the earth, the fruitfulness of the soil was much greater than it is now. Then the ears of corn did not bear 50 or 60, but 400 or 500-fold. Then the corn grew from the bottom to the very top of the stalk, and according to the length of the stalk was the length of the ear. Men, however, are so made that when they are too well off, they no longer value the blessings which come from God, but grow indifferent and careless. One day, a woman was passing by a cornfield, when her little child, who was running beside her, fell into a puddle and dirtied her frock. On this, the mother tore up a handful of the beautiful ears of corn and cleaned the frock with them. When the Lord, who just then came by, saw that, he was angry and said, "Henceforth shall the stalks of corn bear no more ears. Men are no longer worthy of heavenly gifts." The bystanders who heard this were terrified and fell on their knees and prayed that he would still leave something on the stalks, even if the people were undeserving of it, for the sake of the innocent birds which would otherwise have to starve. The Lord, who foresaw their suffering, had pity on them and granted the request, so the ears were left as they now grow. End of story 194. Read by Nicole DiDio, Montpelier, Vermont, USA, April 13, 2022.
Story 195 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. The Grave-Mound. A rich farmer was one day standing in his yard inspecting his fields and gardens. The corn was growing up vigorously, and the fruit trees were heavily laden with fruit. The grain of the year before still lay in such immense heaps on the floors that the rafters could hardly bear it. Then he went into the stable, where were well-fed oxen, fat cows, and horses, bright as looking-glass. At length he went back into his sitting-room and cast a glance at the iron chest in which his money lay. Whilst he was thus standing surveying his riches, all at once there was a loud knock close by him. The knock was not at the door of his room, but at the door of his heart. It opened, and he heard a voice which said to him, "Hast thou done good to thy family with it? Hast thou considered the necessities of the poor? Hast thou shared thy bread with the hungry? Hast thou been contented with what thou hast? Or didst thou always desire to have more?" The heart was not slow in answering, "I have been hard and pitiless, and I have never shown any kindness to my own family. If a beggar came, I turned away my eyes from him. I have not troubled myself about God, but have thought only of increasing my wealth. If everything which the sky covers had been mine own, I should not have had enough." When he was aware of his answer, he was greatly alarmed. His knees began to tremble, and he was forced to sit. Then there was another knock, but the knock was at the door of his room. It was his neighbor, a poor man who had a number of children whom he could no longer satisfy with food. "I know," thought the poor man, "that my neighbor is rich, but he is as hard as he is rich. I don't believe he will help me, but my children are crying for bread, so I will venture it." He said to the rich man, "You do not readily give away anything that is yours, but I stand here like one who feels the water rising above his head. My children are starving. Lend me 4 measures of corn." The rich man looked at him long, and then the first sunbeam of mercy began to melt away a drop of the ice of greediness. "I will not lend thee 4 measures," he answered, "but I will make thee a present of 8, but thou must fulfill 1 condition. "What am I to do?" said the poor man. "When I am dead, thou shalt watch for 3 nights by my grave." The peasant was disturbed in his mind at this request, but in the need in which he was, he would have consented to anything. He accepted, therefore, and carried the corn home with him. It seemed as if the rich man had foreseen what was about to happen, for when 3 days were gone by, he suddenly dropped down dead. No one knew exactly how it came to pass, but no one grieved for him. When he was buried, the poor man remembered his promise. He would willingly have been released from it, but he thought, "After all, he acted kindly by me. I have fed my hungry children with his corn, and even if that were not the case, where I have once given my promise, I must keep it." At nightfall, he went into the churchyard and seated himself on the grave mound. Everything was quiet. Only the moon appeared above the grave, but frequently an owl flew past and uttered her melancholy cry. When the sun rose, the poor man betook himself in safety to his home, and in the same manner the second night passed quietly by. On the evening of the 3rd day, he felt a strange uneasiness. It seemed to him that something was about to happen. When he went out, he saw, by the churchyard wall, a man whom he had never seen before. He was no longer young, had scars on his face, and his eyes looked sharply and eagerly around. He was entirely covered with an old cloak, and nothing was visible but his great riding boots. "What are you looking for here?" the peasant asked. "Are you not afraid of the lonely churchyard?" "I am looking for nothing," he answered, "and I am afraid of nothing. I am like the youngster who went forth to learn how to shiver, and had his labor for his pains, but got the king's daughter to wife and great wealth with her. Only I have remained poor. I am nothing but a paid-off soldier, and I mean to pass the night here, because I have no other shelter." "If you are without fear," said the peasant, "stay with me, and help me to watch that grave there." "To keep watch is a soldier's business," he replied. "Whatever we fall in with here, whether it be good or bad, we will share it between us." The peasant agreed to this, and they seated themselves on the grave together. All was quiet until midnight, when suddenly a shrill whistling was heard in the air, and the 2 watchers perceived the evil one standing bodily before them. "Be off, you ragamuffins," cried he to them. "The man who lies in that grave belongs to me. I want to take him, and if you don't go away, I will wring your necks." "Sir, with the red feather," said the soldier, "you are not my captain. I have no need to obey you, and I have not yet learned how to fear. Go away. We shall stay sitting here." The devil thought to himself, "Money is the best thing with which to get hold of these 2 vagabonds. So he began to play a softer tune and asked quite kindly if they would not accept a bag of money and go home with it. "What is worth listening to," answered the soldier, "but 1 bag of gold won't serve us. If you will give us as much as will go into one of my boots, we will quit the field for you and go away." "I have not so much as that about me," said the devil, "but I will fetch it. In the neighboring town lives a money changer who is a good friend of mine, and he will readily advance it to me." When the devil had vanished, the soldier took his left boot off and said, "We will soon pull the charcoal burner's nose for him. Just give me your knife, comrade." He cut the sole of the boot and put it in the high grass near the grave on the edge of a hole that was half overgrown. "That will do," said he. "Now the chimney sweep may come." They both sat down and waited, and it was not long before the devil returned with a small bag of gold in his hand. "Just pour it in," said the soldier, raising up the boot a little. "But that won't be enough." The black one shook out all that was in the bag, the gold fell through, and the boot remained empty. "Stupid devil," cried the soldier, "it won't do. Didn't I say so at once? Go back again and bring more." The devil shook his head, went, and in an hour's time came with a much larger bag under his arm. "Now pour it in," cried the soldier, "but I doubt the boot won't be full." The gold clinked as it fell, but the boot remained empty. The devil looked in himself with his burning eyes and convinced himself of the truth. "You have shamefully big calves to your legs," cried he, and made a wry face. "Did you think," replied the soldier, "that I have a cloven foot like you? Since when have you been so stingy? See that you get more gold together, or our bargain will come to nothing."
The wicked one went off again. This time he stayed away longer, and when at length he appeared, he was panting under the weight of a sack which lay on his shoulders. He emptied it into the boot, which was just as far from being filled as before. He became furious, and was just going to tear the boot out of the soldier's hands, but at that moment the first ray of the rising sun broke forth from the sky, and the evil spirit fled away with loud shrieks. The poor soul was saved. The peasant wished to divide the gold, but the soldier said, "Give what falls to my lot to the poor. I will come with thee to thy cottage, and together we will live in rest and peace on what remains as long as God is pleased to permit." End of story 195. Read by Nicole DiDio, Montpelier, Vermont, USA, April 17th, 2022.
Story 196 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. Old Rinkrank. There was once on a time a king who had a daughter, and he caused a glass mountain to be made, and said that whosoever could cross to the other side of it without falling should have his daughter to wife. Then there was one who loved the king's daughter, and he asked the king if he might have her. "Yes," said the king, "if you can cross the mountain without falling, you shall have her." And the princess said she would go over it with him, and would hold him if he were about to fall. So they set out together to go over it, and when they were halfway up, the princess slipped and fell, and the glass mountain opened and shut her up inside. And her betrothed could not see where she had gone, for the mountain closed immediately. Then he wept and lamented much, and the king was miserable too, and had the mountain broken open where she had been lost, and though would be able to get her out again, but they could not find the place into which she had fallen. Meanwhile, the king's daughter had fallen quite deep down into the earth into a great cave. An old fellow with a very long gray beard came to meet her, and told her that if she would be his servant and do everything he bade her, she might live. If not, he would kill her. So she did all he bade her. In the mornings, he took his ladder out of his pocket and set it up against the mountain and climbed to the top by its help, and then he drew up the ladder after him. The princess had to cook his dinner, make his bed, and do all his work. And when he came home again, he always brought with him a heap of gold and silver. When she had lived with him for many years, and had grown quite old, he called her Mother Mansrot, and she had to call him Old Rinkrank. Then, once when he was out, she had made his bed and washed his dishes. She shut the doors and windows all fast, and there was one little window through which the light shone in, and this she left open. When Old Rinkrank came home, he knocked at his door and cried, "Mother Mansrot, open the door for me." "No," she said, "Old Rinkrank, I will not open the door for thee." Then he said, "Here stand I, poor Rinkrank, on my 17 long shanks, on my weary, worn-out foot. Wash my dishes, Mother Mansrot." "I have washed thy dishes already," said she. Then again he said, "Here stand I, poor Rinkrank, on my 17 long shanks, on my weary, worn-out foot. Make me my bed, Mother Mansrot." "I have made thy bed already," said she. Then again he said, "Here stand I, poor Rinkrank, on my 17 long shanks, on my weary, worn-out foot. Open the door, Mother Mansrot." Then he ran all round his house, and saw that the little window was open, and thought, "I will look in and see what she can be about, and why she will not open the door for me." He tried to peep in, but could not get his head through because of his long beard. So he first put his beard through the open window, but just as he had got it through, Mother Mansrot came by and pulled the window down with the cord which she had tied to it, and his beard was shut fast in it. Then he began to cry most piteously, for it hurt him very much, and to entreat her to release him again. But she said, not until he gave her the ladder with which he ascended the mountain. Then, whether he would or would not, he had to tell her where the ladder was.
and she fastened a very long ribbon to the window, and then she set up the ladder and ascended the mountain, and when she was at the top of it, she opened the window. She went to her father and told him all that had happened to her. The king rejoiced greatly, and her betrothed was still there, and they went and dug up the mountain and found old Rinkrank inside it with all his gold and silver. Then the king had old Rinkrank put to death and took all his gold and silver. The princess married her betrothed, and lived right happily in great magnificence and joy. End of story 196. Read by Nicole DiDio. Montpelier, Vermont, USA, April 13, 2022.
Story 197 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. The Crystal Ball. There was once an enchantress who had three sons who loved each other as brothers, but the old woman did not trust them and thought they wanted to steal her power from her. So she changed the eldest into an eagle, which was forced to dwell in the Rocky Mountains and was often seen sweeping in great circles in the sky. The second she changed into a whale, which lived in the deep sea, and all that was seen of it was that it sometimes spouted up a great jet of water in the air. Each of them only bore his human form for only 2 hours a day. The third son, who was afraid she might change him into a raging wild beast, a bear perhaps, or a wolf, went secretly away. He had heard that a king's daughter who was bewitched was imprisoned in the castle of the Golden Sun and was waiting for deliverance. Those, however, who tried to free her risked their lives. 23 youths had already died a miserable death, and now only one other might make the attempt, after which no more must come. And as his heart was without fear, he caught at the idea of seeking out the castle of the Golden Sun. He had already traveled about for a long time without being able to find it. When he came by chance into a great forest and did not know the way out of it, all at once he saw in the distance two giants, who made a sign to him with their hands. And when he came to them, they said, "We are quarreling about a cap, and which of us it is to belong to. And as we are equally strong, neither of us can get the better of the other. The small men are cleverer than we are, so we will leave the decision to thee." "How can you dispute about an old cap?" said the youth. "Thou dost not know what properties it has. It is a wishing cap. Whosoever puts it on can wish himself away wherever he likes, and in an instant he will be there." "Give me the cap," said the youth. "I will go to a short distance off, and when I call you, you must run a race, and the cap shall belong to the one who gets first to me." He put it on and went away and thought of the king's daughter, forgot the giants, and walked continually onward. At length he sighed from the very bottom of his heart and cried, "Ah, if I were but at the castle of the Golden Sun!" And hardly had the words passed his lips when he was standing on a high mountain before the gate of the castle. He entered and went through all the rooms until at last he found the king's daughter. But how shocked he was when he saw her! She had an ashen gray face full of wrinkles, blear eyes, and red hair. "Are you the king's daughter, whose beauty the whole world praises?" cried he. "Ah," she answered, "this is not my form. Human eyes can only see me in this state of ugliness. But that thou mayst know what I am like, look in the mirror. It does not let itself be misled. It will show thee my image, as it is in truth." She gave him the mirror in his hand, and he saw therein the likeness of the most beautiful maiden on earth, and saw, too, how the tears were rolling down her cheeks with grief. "Then," said he, "how canst thou be set free? I fear no danger." She said, "He who gets the crystal ball and holds it before the enchanter will destroy his power within it, and I shall resume my true shape." "Ah," she added, "so many have already gone to meet death for this, and thou art so young. I grieve that thou shouldst encounter such great danger." "Nothing can keep me from doing it," said he, "but tell me what I must do." "Thou shalt know everything," said the king's daughter. "When thou descendest the mountain on which the castle stands, a wild bull will stand below by a spring, and thou must fight with it, and if thou hast the luck to kill it, a fiery bird will spring out of it, which bears in its body a burning egg, and in the egg the crystal ball lies like a yolk.
The bird will not, however, let the egg fall until forced to do so, and if it falls on the ground, it will flame up and burn everything that is near, and melt even ice itself, and with it the crystal ball, and then all thy trouble will have been in vain. The youth went down to the spring, where the bull snorted and bellowed at him. After a long struggle, he plunged his sword in the animal's body, and it fell down. Instantly, a fiery bird arose from it and was about to fly away, but the young man's brother, the eagle, who was passing between the clouds, swooped down, hunted it away to the sea, and struck it with his beak until, in its extremity, it let the egg fall. The egg did not, however, fall into the sea, but on a fisherman's hut which stood on the shore, and the hut began at once to smoke and was about to break out in flames. Then arose in the sea waves as high as a house. They streamed over the hut and subdued the fire. The other brother, the whale, had come swimming to them and had driven the water up on high. When the fire was extinguished, the youth sought for the egg and happily found it. It was not yet melted, but the shell was broken by being so suddenly cooled with the water, and he could take out the crystal ball unhurt. When the youth went to the enchanter and held it before him, the latter said, "My power is destroyed, and from this time forth thou art the king of the castle of the golden sun. With this canst thou likewise give back to thy brothers their human form." Then the youth hastened to the king's daughter, and when he entered the room she was standing there in the full splendor of her beauty, and joyfully they exchanged rings with each other. End of story 197. Read by Nicole DiDio, Montpelier, Vermont, USA, April 17th, 2022. Story 198 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. Maid Maleen. There was once a king who had a son, who asked in marriage the daughter of a mighty king. She was called Maid Maleen and was very beautiful. As her father wished to give her to another, the prince was rejected. But as they both loved each other with all their hearts, they would not give each other up. And Maid Maleen said to her father, "I can and will take no other for my husband." Then the king flew into a passion and ordered a dark tower to be built, into which no ray of sunlight or moonlight should enter. When it was finished, he said, "Therein shalt thou be imprisoned for 7 years, and then I will come and see if thy perverse spirit is broken." Meat and drink for the 7 years were carried into the tower, and then she and her waiting woman were led into it and walled up, and thus cut off from the sky and from the earth. There they sat, in the darkness, and knew not when day or night began. The king's son often went round and round the tower and called their names, but no sound from without pierced through the thick walls. What else could they do but lament and complain? Meanwhile, the time passed. And by the diminution of the food and drink, they knew that the 7 years were coming to an end. They thought the moment of their deliverance was come, but no stroke of the hammer was heard, no stone fell out of the wall, and it seemed to Maid Maleen that her father had forgotten her. As they only had food for a short time longer and saw miserable death awaiting them, Maid Maleen said, "We must try our last chance and see if we can break through the wall." She took the bread knife and picked and bored at the mortar of a stone, and when she was tired, the waiting maid took her turn. With great labor, they succeeded in getting out one stone, and then a second, and a third, and then 3 days were over. The first ray of light fell on their darkness, and at last the opening was so large that they could look out. The sky was blue, and the fresh breeze played on their faces. But how melancholy everything looked all around. Her father's castle lay in ruins. The town and the villages were, so far as could be seen, destroyed by fire. The fields far and wide laid to waste, and no human being was visible. When the opening in the wall was large enough for them to slip through, the waiting maid sprang down first, and then Maid Maleen followed. But where were they to go? The enemy had ravaged the whole kingdom, driven away the king, and slain all the inhabitants. They wandered forth to seek another country, but nowhere did they find shelter, or a human being to give them a mouthful of bread, and their need was so great that they were forced to appease their hunger with nettles. When, after long journeying, they came into another country, they tried to get work everywhere, but wherever they knocked, they were turned away, and no one would have pity on them.
At last they arrived in a large city and went to the royal palace. There also they were ordered to go away, but at last the cook said that they might stay in the kitchen and be scullions. The son of the king in whose kingdom they were was, however, the very man who had been betrothed to Maid Maleen. His father had chosen another bride for him, whose face was as ugly as her heart was wicked. The wedding was fixed, and the maiden had already arrived. But because of her great ugliness, however, she shut herself in her room and allowed no one to see her, and Maid Maleen had to take her meals from the kitchen. When the day came for the bride and the bridegroom to go to church, she was ashamed of her ugliness and afraid that if she showed herself in the streets, she would be mocked and laughed at by the people. Then said she to Maid Maleen, "A great piece of luck has befallen thee. I have sprained my foot and cannot well walk through the streets. Thou shalt put on my wedding clothes and take my place, a greater honor than that thou canst not have." Maid Maleen, however, refused it and said, "I wish for no honor which is not suitable for me." It was in vain, too, that the bride offered her gold. At last she said angrily, "If thou dost not obey me, it shall cost thee thy life. I have but to speak the word, and thy head will lie at thy feet." Then she was forced to obey and put on the bride's magnificent clothes and all her jewels. When she entered the royal hall, everyone was amazed at her great beauty, and the king said to his son, "This is the bride whom I have chosen for thee, and whom thou must lead to church." The bridegroom was astonished and thought, "She is like my Maid Maleen, and I should believe that it was she herself, but she has long been shut up in the tower or dead." He took her by the hand and led her to church. On the way was a nettle plant, and she said, "Oh, nettle plant, little nettle plant, what's dost thou here alone? I have known the time when I ate thee unboiled, when I ate thee unroasted." "What art thou saying?" asked the king's son. "Nothing," she replied. "I was only thinking of Maid Maleen." He was surprised that she knew about her, but kept silence. When they came to the footplank into the churchyard, she said, "Footbridge, do not break. I am not the true bride." "What art thou saying there?" asked the king's son. "Nothing," she replied. "I was only thinking of Maid Maleen." "Dost thou know Maid Maleen?" "No," she answered. "How should I know her? I have only heard of her." When they came to the church door, she said once more, "Church door, break not. I am not the true bride." "What art thou saying there?" asked he. "Ah," she answered, "I was only thinking of Maid Maleen." Then he took out a precious chain, put it round her neck, and fastened the clasp. Thereupon they entered the church, and the priest joined their hands together before the altar and married them. He led her home, but she did not speak a single word the whole way. When they got back to the royal palace, she hurried into the bride's chamber, put off the magnificent clothes and the jewels, dressed herself in her gray gown, and kept nothing but the jewel on her neck, which she had received from the bridegroom. When the night came and the bride was to be led into the prince's apartment, she let her veil fall over her face, that he might not observe the deception. As soon as everyone had gone away, he said to her, "What didst thou say to the nettle plant which was growing by the wayside?" "To which nettle plant?" asked she. "I don't talk to nettle plants." "If thou didst not do it, then thou art not the true bride," said he. So she bethought herself and said, "I must go out unto my maid, who keeps my thoughts for me." She went out and sought Maid Maleen. "Girl, what hast thou been saying to the nettle?" "I said nothing but, 'O nettle plant, little nettle plant, what dost thou here alone? I have known the time when I ate thee unboiled, when I ate thee unroasted.'" The bride ran back into the chamber and said, "I know now what I said to the nettle," and she repeated the words which she had just heard. "But what didst thou say to the footbridge when we went over it?" asked the king's son. "To the footbridge," she answered. "I don't talk to footbridges." "Then thou art not the true bride." She again said, "I must go out unto my maid, who keeps my thoughts for me," and ran out and found Maid Maleen. "Girl, what didst thou say to the footbridge?" "I said nothing but, 'Footbridge, do not break. I am not the true bride.'" "That costs thee thy life," cried the bride. But she hurried into the room and said, "I know now what I said to the footbridge," and she repeated the words. "But what didst thou say to the church door?" "To the church door," she replied. "I don't talk to church doors." "Then thou art not the true bride." She went out and found Maid Maleen and said, "Girl, what didst thou say to the church door?" "I said nothing but, 'Church door, break not. I am not the true bride.'"
"That will break thy neck for thee," cried the bride, and flew into a terrible passion. But she hastened back into the room and said, "I know now what I said to the church door," and she repeated the words, "But where hast thou the jewel which I gave thee at the church door?" "What jewel?" she answered. "Thou didst not give me any jewel. I myself put it round thy neck, and I myself fastened it. If thou dost not know that, thou art not the true bride." He drew the veil from her face, and when he saw her immeasurable ugliness, he sprang back terrified and said, "How comest thou here? Who art thou? I am thy betrothed bride, but because I feared lest the people should mock me when they saw me out of doors, I commanded the scullery maid to dress herself in my clothes and to go to church instead of me." "Where is this girl?" said he. "I want to see her. Go and bring her here." She went out and told the servants that the scullery maid was an impostor, and that they must take her out into the courtyard and strike off her head. The servants laid hold of Maid Maleen and wanted to drag her out, but she screamed so loudly for help that the king's son heard her voice, hurried out of his chamber, and ordered them to set the maiden free instantly. Lights were brought, and then he saw on her neck the gold chain which he had given her at the church door. "Thou art the true bride," said he, "who went with me to the church. Come with me now to my room." When they were both alone, he said, "On the way to the church, thou didst name Maid Maleen, who was my betrothed bride. If I could believe it possible, I should think she was standing before me. Thou art like her in every respect." She answered, "I am Maid Maleen, who for thy sake was imprisoned 7 years in the darkness, who suffered hunger and thirst, and has lived so long in want and poverty. Today, however, the sun is shining on me once more. I was married to thee in the church, and I am thy lawful wife." Then they kissed each other and were happy all the days of their lives. The false bride was rewarded for what she had done by having her head cut off. The tower in which Maid Maleen had been imprisoned remained standing for a long time, and when the children passed by it, they sang, "Cling, clang, Gloria, who sits within this tower? A king's daughter, she sits within a side of her I cannot win. The wall it will not break, the stone cannot be pierced. Little hands, your coat so gay, follow me, fast as you may." End of story 198, read by Nicole DiDio, Montpelier, Vermont, USA, April 17, 2022. Story 199 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. The Boots of Buffalo Leather. A soldier, who is afraid of nothing, troubles himself about nothing. One of this kind had received his discharge, and as he had learnt no trade and could earn nothing, he travelled about and begged alms of kind people. He had an old waterproof on his back, and a pair of riding boots of buffalo leather, which were still left to him. One day he was walking, he knew not where, straight out into the open country, and at length came to a forest. He did not know where he was, but saw sitting on the trunk of a tree, which had been cut down, a man who was well-dressed and wore a green shooting coat. The soldier shook hands with him, sat down on the grass by his side, and stretched out his legs. "I see thou hast good boots on, which are well-blackened," said he to the huntsman. "But if thou hadst to travel about as I have, they would not last long. Look at mine, they are of buffalo leather, and I have been worn for a long time, but in them I can go through thick and thin." After a while the soldier got up and said, "I can stay no longer, hunger drives me onwards. But, brother Bright Boots, where does this road lead to?" "I don't know that myself," answered the huntsman, "I have lost my way in the forest." "Then thou art in the same plight as I," said the soldier. "Birds of a feather flocked together. Let us remain together and seek our way." The huntsman smiled a little, and they walked on further and further until night fell. "We do not get out of the forest," said the soldier, "but there is in the distance I see a light shining, which will help us to something to eat." They found a stone house, knocked at the door, and an old woman opened it. "We are looking for quarters for the night," said the soldier, "and some lining for our stomachs, for mine is as empty as an old knapsack. "You cannot stay here," answered the old woman. "This is a robber's house, and you would do wisely to get away before they come home, or you will be lost." "It won't be so bad as that," answered the soldier. "I have not had a mouthful for 2 days, and whether I am murdered here or die of hunger in the forest is all the same to me. I shall go in." The huntsman would not follow, but the soldier drew him in with him by the sleeve. "Come, my dear brother, we shall not come to an end so quickly as that." The old woman had pity on them and said, "Creep in here behind the stove, and if they leave anything, I will give it to you on the sly when they are asleep." Scarcely were they in the corner before 12 robbers came bursting in, seated themselves at the table which was already laid, and vehemently demanded some food. The old woman brought in some great dishes of roast meat, and the robbers enjoyed that thoroughly. When the smell of the food ascended the nostrils of the soldier, he said to the huntsman, "I cannot hold out any longer. I shall seat myself at the table and eat with them." "Thou wilt bring us to destruction," said the huntsman, and he held him back by the arm. But the soldier began to cough loudly. When the robbers heard that, they threw away their knives and forks, leapt up, and discovered the two who were behind the stove. "Aha, gentlemen, are you in the corner?" cried they. "What are you doing here? Have you been sent as spies? Wait a while, and you shall learn how to fly on a dry bough." "But do be civil," said the soldier. "I am hungry. Give me something to eat, and then you can do what you like with me." The robbers were astonished, and the captain said, "I see that thou hast no fear. Well, thou shalt have some food, but after that thou must die." "We shall see," said the soldier, and seated himself at the table and began to cut away valiantly at the roast meat. "Brother Brightboots, come and eat," cried he to the huntsman. "Thou must be as hungry as I am, and cannot have better roast meat at home." But the huntsman would not eat. The robbers looked at the soldier in astonishment and said, "The rascal uses no ceremony." After a while, he said, "I have had enough food. Now get me something good to drink." The captain was in the mood to humor him in this also, and called to the old woman, "Bring a bottle out of the cellar, and mind it be of the best." The soldier drew the cork out with a loud noise, and then went with the bottle to the huntsman and said, "Pay attention, brother, and thou shalt see something that will surprise thee. I am now going to drink the health of the whole clan." Then he brandished the bottle over the heads of the robbers and cried, "Long life to you all, but with your mouths open and your right hands lifted up." And then he drank a hearty draught. Scarcely were the words said than they all sat motionless as if made of stone, and their mouths were open and their right hands stretched up in the air. The huntsman said to the soldier, "I see that thou art acquainted with tricks of another kind, but now come and let us go home." "Oho, my dear brother, but that would be marching away far too soon. We have conquered the enemy and must first take the booty. Those men there are sitting fast and are opening their mouths with astonishment, but they will not be allowed to move until I permit them. Come, eat and drink." The old woman had to bring another bottle of the best wine, and the soldier would not stir until he had eaten enough to last for 3 days. At last, when day came, he said, "Now it is time to strike our tents, and that our march may be a short one. The old woman shall show us the nearest way to the town." When they had arrived there, he went to his old comrades and said, "Out in the forest I have found a nest full of gallows birds. Come with me, and we will take it." The soldier led them and said to the huntsman, "Thou must go back again with me to see how they shake when we seize them by the feet." He placed the men round about the robbers, and then he took the bottle, drank a mouthful, brandished it above them, and cried, "Live again!" Instantly they all regained the power of movement, but were thrown down and bound hand and foot with cords. Then the soldier ordered them to be thrown into a cart as if they had been so many sacks, and said, "Now drive them straight to prison." The huntsman, however, took one of the men aside and gave him another commission besides. "Brother Brightboots," said the soldier, "we have safely routed the enemy and been well fed. Now we will quietly walk behind them as if we were stragglers." When they approached the town, the soldier saw a crowd of people pouring through the gate of the town who were raising loud cries of joy and waving green boughs in the air. Then he saw that the entire bodyguard was coming up. "What can this mean?" said he to the huntsman. "Dost thou not know," he replied, "that the king has for a long time been absent from his kingdom, and that today he is returning and everyone is going to meet him?" "But where is the king?" said the soldier. "I do not see him." "Here he is," answered the huntsman. "I am the king, and have announced my arrival." Then he opened his hunting coat, and his royal garments were visible. The soldier was alarmed, and fell on his knees, and begged him to forgive him for having, in his ignorance, treated him as an equal, and spoken to him by such a name. But the king shook hands with him, and said, "Thou art a brave soldier, and hast saved my life. Thou shalt never again be in want. I will take care of thee. And if ever thou wouldst like to eat a piece of roast meat, as good as that in the robber's house, come to the royal kitchen. But if thou wouldst drink a health, thou must first ask my permission." End of story 199, read by Nicole Didio, Montpelier, Vermont, USA, April 17, 2022. Story 200 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. The Golden Key. In the wintertime, when deep snow lay on the ground, a poor boy was forced to go out on a sledge to fetch wood. When he had gathered it together and packed it, he wished, as he was so frozen with cold, not to go home at once, but to light a fire and warm himself a little. So he scraped away the snow, and as he was thus clearing the ground, he found a tiny gold key. Hereupon he thought that where the key was, the lock must be also, and dug in the ground and found an iron chest. "If the key does but fit," thought he, "no doubt there are precious things in that little box." He searched, but no keyhole was there. At last he discovered one, but so small that it was hardly visible. He tried it, and the key fitted it exactly. Then he turned it once round, and now we must wait until he has quite unlocked it and opened the lid, and then we shall learn what wonderful things were lying in that box. End of story 200. Read by Nicole Didio, Montpelier, Vermont, USA, April 13, 2022.
Story 201 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. Children's Legends. Legend 1. Saint Joseph in the Forest. There was once on a time a mother who had three daughters, the eldest of whom was rude and wicked, the second much better, although she had her faults. But the youngest was a pious, good child. The mother was, however, so strange that it was just the eldest daughter whom she most loved, and she could not bear the youngest. On this account, she often sent the poor girl out into the great forest in order to get rid of her, for she thought she would lose herself and never come back again. But the guardian angel, which every good child has, did not forsake her, but always brought her into the right path again. Once, however, the guardian angel behaved as if he were not there, and the child could not find her way out of the forest again. She walked on constantly until evening came, and then she saw a tiny light burning in the distance, ran up to it at once, and came to a little hut. She knocked, the door opened, and she came to a second door, where she knocked again. An old man, who had a snow-white beard, and looked venerable, opened it for her, and he was no other than Saint Joseph. He said quite kindly, "Come, dear child, seat thyself on my little chair by the fire, and warm thyself. I will fetch thee clear water if thou art thirsty. But here in the forest I have nothing for thee to eat, but a couple of little roots, which thou must first scrape and boil." Saint Joseph gave her the roots. The girl scraped them clean, Then she brought a piece of pancake and the bread that her mother had given her to take with her, mixed all together in a pan, and cooked herself a thick soup. When it was ready, Saint Joseph said, "I am hungry. Give me some of thy food." The child was quite willing, and gave him more than she kept for herself. But God's blessing was with her, so that she was satisfied. When they had eaten, Saint Joseph said, "Now we will go to bed. I have, however, only one bed. Lay thyself in it. I will lie on the ground on the straw." "No," answered she, "stay in your own bed. The straw is soft enough for me." Saint Joseph, however, took the child in his arms and carried her into the little bed, and there she said her prayers and fell asleep. Next morning, when she awoke, she wanted to say good morning to Saint Joseph, but she did not see him. Then she got up and looked for him, but could not find him anywhere. At last she perceived, behind the door, a bag with money so heavy that she could just carry it, and on it was written that it was for the child who had slept there that night. On this she took the bag, bounded away with it, and got safely to her mother. And as she gave her mother all the money, she could not help being satisfied with her. The next day, the second child also took a fancy to go into the forest. Her mother gave her a much larger piece of pancake and bread. It happened with her just as with the first child. In the evening, she came to Saint Joseph's little hut, who gave her roots for a thick soup. When it was ready, he likewise said to her, "I am so hungry. Give me some of thy food." Then the child said, "You may have your share." Afterwards, when Saint Joseph offered her his bed and wanted to lie on the straw, she replied, "No, lie down in the bed. There's plenty of room for both of us." Saint Joseph took her in his arms and put her in the bed and laid himself on the straw. In the morning, when the child awoke and looked for Saint Joseph, he had vanished. But behind the door she found a little sack of money that was about as long as a hand, and on it was written that it was for the child who had slept there last night. So she took the little bag and ran home with it, and took it to her mother. But she secretly kept two pieces for herself. The eldest daughter had by this time grown curious, and the next morning also insisted on going out into the forest. Her mother gave her pancakes with her, as many as she wanted, and bread and cheese as well. In the evening, she found Saint Joseph in his little hut, just as the two others had found him. When the soup was ready, and Saint Joseph said, "I am so hungry. Give me some of thy food," the girl answered,
"Wait until I am satisfied. Then, if there is anything left, thou shalt have it."
She ate, however, nearly the whole of it, and Saint Joseph had to scrape the dish. Afterwards, the good old man offered her his bed and wanted to lie on the straw. She took it without making any opposition, laid herself down in the little bed, and left the hard straw to the white-haired man. Next morning, when she awoke, Saint Joseph was not to be found. But she did not trouble herself about that. She looked behind the door for a money bag. She fancied something was lying on the ground, but as she could not very well distinguish what it was, she stooped down and examined it closely. But it remained hanging to her nose, and when she got up again, she saw, to her horror, that it was a second nose, which was hanging fast to her own. Then she began to scream and howl, but that did no good. She was forced to see it always on her nose, for it stretched out so far. Then she ran out and screamed without stopping till she met St. Joseph, at whose feet she fell and begged until, out of pity, he took the nose off her again, and even gave her 2 farthings. When she got home, her mother was standing before the door, and asked, "What hast thou had given to thee?" Then she lied, and said, "A great bag of money, but I have lost it on the way."
"Lost it?" cried the mother. "Oh, but we will soon find it again,"
and took her by the hand and wanted to seek it with her. At first she began to cry and did not wish to go, but at last she went. On the way, however, so many lizards and snakes broke loose on both of them that they did not know how to save themselves. At last they stung the wicked child to death, and they stung the mother in the foot, because she had not brought her up better. End of story 201. This recording is in the public domain. Story 202 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. Children's Legends. Legend 2. The 12 Apostles. 300 years before the birth of the Lord Christ, there lived a mother who had 12 sons, but was so poor and needy that she no longer knew how she was to keep them alive at all. She prayed to God daily that he would grant that all her sons might be on the earth with the Redeemer who was promised. When her necessity became still greater, she sent one of them after the other out into the world to seek bread for her. The eldest was called Peter, and he went out and had already walked a long way, a whole day's journey, when he came into a great forest. He sought for a way out, but could find none, and went farther and farther astray, and at the same time felt such great hunger that he could scarcely stand. At length he became so weak that he was forced to lie down, and he believed death to be at hand. Suddenly there stood beside him a small boy who shone with brightness and was as beautiful and kind as an angel. The child smote his little hands together until Peter was forced to look up and saw him. Then the child said, "Why art thou sitting there in such trouble?" "Alas," answered Peter, "I am going about the world seeking bread, that I may yet see the dear Savior who is promised. That is my greatest desire." The child said, "Come with me, and thy wish shall be fulfilled." He took poor Peter by the hand and led him between some cliffs to a great cavern. When they entered it, everything was shining with gold, silver, and crystal, and in the midst of it 12 cradles were standing side by side. Then said the little angel, "Lie down in the first, and sleep a while. I will rock thee." Peter did so, and the angel sang to him, and rocked him until he was asleep. And when he was asleep, the second brother came also, guided thither by his guardian angel, and he was rocked to sleep like the first. And thus came the others, one after the other, until all 12 lay there sleeping in the golden cradles. They slept, however, 300 years, until the night when the Savior of the world was born. Then they awoke, and were with him on earth, and were called the 12 Apostles. End of story 202. This recording is in the public domain. Story 203 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. Children's Legends. Legend 3. The Rose. There was once a poor woman who had 2 children. The youngest had to go every day into the forest to fetch wood. Once, when she had gone a long way to seek it, a little child who was quite strong came and helped her industriously to pick up the wood and carry it home. And then, before a moment had passed, the strange child disappeared. The child told her mother this, but at first she would not believe it. At length she brought a rose home, and told her mother that the beautiful child had given her this rose, and had told her that when it was full in bloom, he would return. The mother put the rose in water. One morning her child could not get out of bed. The mother went to the bed and found her dead, but she lay looking very happy. On the same morning, the rose was in full bloom. End of story 203. This recording is in the public domain. Story 204 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. Children's Legends. Legend 4. Poverty and humility lead to heaven. There was once a king's son who went out into the world, and he was full of thought and sad. He looked at the sky, which was so beautifully pure and blue. Then he sighed and said, "How well must all be with one up there in heaven?" Then he saw a poor gray-haired man who was coming along the road towards him, and he spoke to him and asked, "How can I get to heaven?" The man answered, "By poverty and humility. Put on my ragged clothes, wander about the world for 7 years, and get to know what misery is. Take no money, but if thou art hungry, ask compassionate hearts for a bit of bread. In this way thou wilt reach heaven." Then the king's son took off his magnificent coat and wore in its place the beggar's garment, went out into the wide world and suffered great misery. He took nothing but a little food, said nothing, but prayed to the Lord to take him into his heaven. When the 7 years were over, he returned to his father's palace, but no one recognized him. He said to the servants, "Go and tell my parents that I have come back again, But the servants did not believe it, and laughed, and left him standing there. Then said he, Go and tell it to my brothers, that they may come down, for I should so like to see them again. The servants would not do that either. But at last one of them went and told it to the king's children. But these did not believe it, and did not trouble themselves about it. Then he wrote a letter to his mother, and described to her all his misery, but he did not say that he was her son. So, out of pity, the queen had a place under the stairs assigned to him, and food taken to him daily by two servants. But one of them was ill-natured and said, Why should the beggar have the good food? And kept it for himself, or gave it to the dogs, and took the weak, wasted away beggar nothing but water. The other, however, was honest, and took the beggar what was sent to him. It was little, but he could live on it for a while. And all the time he was quite patient, but he grew continually weaker. As, however, his illness increased, he desired to receive the last sacrament. When the host was being elevated down below, all the bells in the town and neighborhood began to ring. After Mass, the priest went to the poor man under the stairs, and there he lay dead. In one hand he had a rose, in the other a lily, and beside him was a paper in which was written his story. When he was buried, a rose grew on one side of his grave, and a lily on the other. End of story 204. This recording is in the public domain. Story 205 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. Children's Legends. Legend 5. God's Food. There were once upon a time two sisters, one of whom had no children and was rich, and the other had five, and was a widow, and so poor that she no longer had food enough to satisfy herself and her children. In her need, therefore, she went to her sister and said, My children and I are suffering the greatest hunger. Thou art rich. Give me a mouthful of bread. The very rich sister was as hard as a stone, and said,
I myself have nothing in the house,
and drove away the poor creature with harsh words. After some time, the husband of the rich sister came home, and was just going to cut himself a piece of bread, but when he made the first cut into the loaf, out flowed red blood. When the woman saw that, she was terrified, and told him what had occurred. He hurried away to help the widow and her children, but when he entered her room, he found her praying. She had her two youngest children in her arms, and the three eldest were lying dead. He offered her food, but she answered, For earthly food have we no longer any desire. God has already satisfied the hunger of three of us, and he will hearken to our supplications likewise. Scarcely had she uttered these words than the two little ones drew their last breath, whereupon her heart broke, and she sank down dead. End of story 205. This recording is in the public domain.
Story 206
story 206 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. Children's Legends. Legend 6. The Three Green Twigs. There was once on a time a hermit who lived in a forest at the foot of a mountain and passed his time in prayer and good works, and every evening he carried to the glory of God 2 pails of water up the mountain. Many a beast drank of it, and many a plant was refreshed by it, for on the heights above a strong wind blew continually, which dried the air and the ground, and the wild birds which dread mankind wheel about there, and with their sharp eyes search for a drink. And because the hermit was so pious, an angel of God, visible to his eyes, went up with him, counted his steps, and when the work was completed, brought him his food, even as the prophet of old was by God's command fed by the raven. When the hermit, in his piety, had already reached a great age, it happened that he once saw from afar a poor sinner being taken to the gallows. He said carelessly to himself, "There, that one is getting his deserts." In the evening, when he was carrying the water up the mountain, the angel who usually accompanied him did not appear, and also brought him no food. Then he was terrified and searched his heart and tried to think how he could have sinned, as God was so angry, but he did not discover it. Then he neither ate nor drank, threw himself down on the ground, and prayed day and night. And as he was one day thus bitterly weeping in the forest, he heard a little bird singing beautifully and delightfully, and then he was still more troubled, and said, "How joyously thou singest! The Lord is not angry with thee. Ah, if thou couldst but tell me how I can have offended him, that I might do penance, and then my heart also would be glad again." Then the bird began to speak and said, "Thou hast done injustice, in that thou hast condemned a poor sinner who was being led to the gallows, and for that the Lord is angry with thee. He alone sits in judgment. However, if thou wilt do penance and repent of thy sins, he will forgive thee." Then the angel stood beside him with a dry branch in his hand and said, "Thou shalt carry this dry branch until 3 green twigs sprout out of it. But at night, when thou wilt sleep, thou shalt lay it under thy head. Thou shalt beg thy bread from door to door, and not tarry more than one night in the same house. That is the penance which the Lord lays on thee." Then the hermit took the piece of wood and went back into the world, which he had not seen for so long. He ate and drank nothing but what was given him at the doors. Many petitions were, however, not listened to, and many doors remained shut to him, so that he often did not get a crumb of bread. Once, when he had gone from door to door from morning till night, and no one had given him anything, and no one would shelter him for the night, he went forth into a forest, and at last found a cave which someone had made, and an old woman was sitting in it. Then said he, "Good woman, keep me with you in your house for this night." But she said,
No, I dare not, even if I wished. I have 3 sons who are wicked and wild. If they come home from their robbing expedition and find you, they would kill us both.
The hermit said, Let me stay. They will do no injury either to you or to me. And the woman was compassionate and let herself be persuaded. Then the man lay down beneath the stairs and put the bit of wood under his head. When the old woman saw him do that, she asked the reason of it, on which he told her that he carried the bit of wood about with him for a penance, and used it at night for a pillow, and that he had offended the Lord, because when he had seen a poor sinner on the way to the gallows, he had said he was getting his deserts. Then the woman began to weep and cried,
If the Lord thus punishes one single word, how will it fare with my sons when they appear before him in judgment?
At midnight the robbers came home and blustered and stormed. They made a fire, and when it had lighted up the cave, and they saw a man lying under the stairs, they fell in a rage and cried to their mother,
Who is the man? Have we not forbidden anyone whatsoever to be taken in?
Then said the mother,
Let him alone. It is a poor sinner who is expiating his crime.
The robbers asked,
What has he done? Old man, cried they, tell us thy sins.
The old man raised himself and told them how he, by one single word, had so sinned that God was angry with him, and how he was now expiating this crime. The robbers were so powerfully touched in their hearts by this story that they were shocked with their life up to this time, reflected, and began with hearty repentance to do penance for it. The hermit, after he had converted the 3 sinners, lay down to sleep again under the stairs. In the morning, however, they found him dead, and out of the dry wood on which his head lay, 3 green twigs had grown up on high. Thus the Lord had once more received him into his favor. End of story 206. This recording is in the public domain. Story 207 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. Children's Legends. Legend 7. Our Lady's Little Glass. Once upon a time, a wagoner's cart, which was heavily laden with wine, had stuck so fast that in spite of all that he could do, he could not get it to move again. Then it chanced that Our Lady just happened to come by that way, and when she perceived the poor man's distress, she said to him, I am tired and thirsty. Give me a glass of wine, and I will set thy cart free for thee. Willingly, answered the wagoner, but I have no glass in which I can give thee the wine. Then Our Lady plucked a little white flower with red stripes called field bindweed, which looks very like a glass, and gave it to the wagoner. He filled it with wine, and then Our Lady drank it, and in the self-same instant the cart was set free, and the wagoner could drive onwards. The little flower is still always called Our Lady's Little Glass. End of story 207. This recording is in the public domain. Story 208 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. Children's Legends. Legend 8. The Aged Mother. In a large town there was an old woman who sat in the evening alone in her room, thinking how she had lost first her husband, then both her children, then one by one all her relations, and at length, that very day, her last friend. And now she was quite alone and desolate. She was very sad at heart, and heaviest of all her losses to her was that of her sons, and in her pain she blamed God for it. She was still sitting lost in thought when all at once she heard the bells ringing for early prayer. She was surprised that she had thus in her sorrow watched through the whole night, and lighted her lantern and went to church. It was already lighted up when she arrived, but not as it usually was, with wax candles, but with a dim light. It was also crowded already with people, and all the seats were filled, and when the old woman got to her usual place, it also was not empty, but the whole bench was entirely full. And when she looked at the people, they were none other than her dead relations, who were sitting there in their old-fashioned garments, but with pale faces. They neither spoke nor sang, but a soft humming and whispering was heard all over the church. Then an aunt of hers stood up, stepped forward, and said to the poor old woman, "Look there, beside the altar, and thou wilt see thy sons." The old woman looked there, and saw her two children, one hanging on the gallows, the other bound to the wheel. Then said the aunt, "Behold, so would it have been with them if they had lived, and if the good God had not taken them to himself when they were innocent children." The old woman went trembling home, and on her knees thanked God for having dealt with her more kindly than she had been able to understand, and on the third day she lay down and died. End of story 208. This recording is in the public domain. Story 209 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. Children's Legends. Legend 9. The Heavenly Wedding. A poor peasant boy one day heard the priest say in church that whosoever desired to enter into the kingdom of heaven must always go straight onward. So he set out and walked continually straight onwards over hill and valley without ever turning aside. At length his way led him into a great town, and into the midst of a church, where just at that time God's service was being performed. Now when he beheld all the magnificence of this, he thought he had reached heaven, sat down, and rejoiced with his whole heart. When the service was over, and the clerk made him go out, he replied, "No, I will not go out again. I am glad to be in heaven at last." So the clerk went to the priest and told him that there was a child in the church who would not go out again because he believed he was in heaven. The priest said, "If he believes that, we will leave him inside." So he went to him and asked if he had any inclination to work. "Yes," the little fellow replied, "I am accustomed to work, but I will not go out of heaven again." So he stayed in the church, and when he saw how the people came and knelt and prayed to Our Lady with the Blessed Child Jesus, which was carved in wood, he thought, "That is the good God," and said, "Dear God, how thin you are! The people must certainly let you starve, but every day I will give you half my dinner." From this time forth, he every day took half his dinner to the image, and the image began to enjoy the food. When a few weeks had gone by, people remarked that the image was growing larger and stout and strong, and wondered much. The priest also could not understand it, but stayed in the church and followed the little boy about. And then he saw how he shared his food with the Virgin Mary, and how she accepted it. After some time, the boy became ill, and for 8 days could not leave his bed. But as soon as he could get up again, the first thing he did was to take his food to Our Lady. The priest followed him and heard him say, "Dear God, do not take it amiss that I have not brought you anything for such a long time, for I have been ill and could not get up." Then the image answered him and said, "I have seen thy good will, and that is enough for me. Next Sunday thou shalt go with me to the wedding." The boy rejoiced at this and repeated it to the priest, who begged him to go and ask the image if he too might be permitted to go. "No," answered the image, "thou alone." The priest wished to prepare him first and gave him the Holy Communion, and the child was willing, and next Sunday, when the host came to him, he fell down and died, and was at the eternal wedding. End of story 209. This recording is in the public domain. Story 210 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. Children's Legends. Legend 10. The Hazel-Branch. One afternoon, the Christ child had laid himself in his cradle bed and had fallen asleep. Then his mother came to him, looked at him full of gladness, and said, "Hast thou laid thyself down to sleep, my child? Sleep sweetly, and in the meantime I will go into the wood and fetch thee a handful of strawberries, for I know that thou wilt be pleased with them when thou awakest." In the wood outside, she found a spot with the most beautiful strawberries, but as she was stooping down to gather one, an adder sprang up out of the grass. She was alarmed, left the strawberries where they were, and hastened away. The adder darted after her, but Our Lady, as you can readily understand, knew what it was best to do. She hid herself behind a hazel bush and stood there until the adder had crept away again. Then she gathered the strawberries, and as she set out on her way home, she said, "As the hazel bush has been my protection this time, it shall in future protect others also." Therefore, from the most remote times, a green hazel branch has been the safest protection against adders, snakes, and everything else which creeps on the earth. End of story 210. This recording is in the public domain.
Story 211 of Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Read by Jennifer Painter. Household Tales by Brothers Grimm. The 12 Idle Servants. 12 servants who had done nothing all the day would not exert themselves at night either, but laid themselves on the grass and boasted of their idleness. The first said, "What is your laziness to me? I have to concern myself about mine own. The care of my body is my principal work. I eat not a little and drink still more. When I have had 4 meals, I fast a short time until I feel hunger again, and that suits me best. To rise betimes is not for me. When it is getting near midday, I already seek out a resting place for myself. If the master call, I do exactly as if I had not heard him, and if he call for the second time, I wait a while before I get up and go to him very slowly. In this way, life is endurable." The second said, "I have a horse to look after, but I leave the bit in his mouth, and if I do not want to do it, I give him no food, and I say he has had it already. I, however, lay myself in the oak chest and sleep for 4 hours. After this I stretch out 1 foot and move it a couple of times over the horse's body, and then he is combed and cleaned. Who is going to make a great business of that? Nevertheless, service is too toilsome for me." The third said, "I plague oneself with work. Nothing comes of it. I laid myself in the sun and fell asleep. It began to rain a little, but why should I get up? I let it rain on in God's name. At last came a splashing shower, so heavy indeed, that it pulled the hair out of my head and washed it away, and I got a hole in the skull. I put a plaster on it, and then it was all right. I have already had several injuries of that kind." The fourth said, "If I am to undertake a piece of work, I first loiter about for an hour that I may save up my strength. After that I begin quite slowly, and ask if no one is there who could help me. Then I let him do the chief of the work, and in reality only look on. But that also is still too much for me." The fifth said, "What does that matter? Just think. I am to take away the manure from the horse's stable and load the cart with it. I let it go on slowly, and if I have taken anything on the fork, I only half raise it up, and then I rest just a quarter of an hour until I quite throw it in. It is enough and to spare if I take out a cartful in the day. I have no fancy for killing myself with work." The sixth said, "Shame on ye. I am afraid of no work, but I lie down for 3 weeks and never once take my clothes off. What is the use of buckling your shoes on? For aught I care, they may fall off my feet. It is no matter. If I am going up some steps, I drag 1 foot slowly after the other onto the first step, and then I count the rest of them, that I may know where I must rest." The seventh said, "That will not do with me. My master looks after my work, only he is not at home the whole day. But I neglect nothing. I run as fast as it is possible to do when one crawls. If I am to get on, 4 sturdy men must push me with all their might. I came where 6 men were lying sleeping on a bed beside each other. I lay down by them and slept too. There was no wakening me again, and when they wanted to have me home, they had to carry me. The 8th said, I see plainly that I am the only active fellow. If a stone lie before me, I do not give myself the trouble to raise my legs and step over it. I lay myself down on the ground, and if I am wet and covered with mud and dirt, I stay lying until the sun has dried me again. At the very most, I only turn myself so that it can shine on me. The 9th said, That is the right way. Today the bread was before me, but I was too idle to take it, and nearly died of hunger. Moreover, a jug stood by it, but it was so big and heavy that I did not like to lift it up, and preferred bearing thirst. Just to turn myself round was too much for me. I remained lying like a log the whole day. The 10th said, Laziness has brought misfortune on me, a broken leg and swollen calf. 3 of us were lying in the road, and I had my leg stretched out. Someone came with a cart, and the wheels went over me. I might indeed have drawn my legs back, but I did not hear the cart coming, for the midges were humming about my ears, and creeping in at my nose, and out again at my mouth. Who can take the trouble to drive the vermin away? The 11th said, I gave up my place yesterday. I had no fancy for carrying the heavy books to my master any longer, or fetching them away again. There was no end of it all day long. But to tell the truth, he gave me my dismissal, and would not keep me any longer, for his clothes, which I had left lying in the dust, were all moth-eaten, and I am very glad of it. The 12th said, Today I had to drive the cart into the country, and made myself a bed of straw on it, and had a good sleep. The reins slipped out of my hand, and when I awoke, the horse had nearly torn itself loose. The harness was gone, the strap which fastened the horse to the shafts was gone, and so were the collar, the bridle, and bit. Someone had come by who had carried all off. Besides this, the cart had got into a quagmire and stuck fast. I left it standing, and stretched myself on the straw again. At last the master came himself and pushed the cart out, and if he had not come, I should not be lying here but there, and sleeping in full tranquillity. End of story 211.